Good evening, everyone. Today, in our 43rd author interaction, we'll be discussing the critically acclaimed book, Gurudath, The Unfinished Story, written by none other than Yasir Usman. In fact, Yasir is Bollywood's most loved biographer. He's also the author of the three best-selling biographies on Rajesh Khanna, you have then Sanjay Dutt and Rekha. Yasir is an awarded journalist and is also a television media professional with over 15 years in progressive roles with well-known media houses. He has been a recipient of the most prestigious Ramnath Goenka Award for Excellence in Journalism, Indian Telly Award, Red Ink Award, among many others. So welcome, Yasir, to our Choose. I'll start with my question straight away, Yasir. So one question which actually comes to my mind again and again, and that was really the reason why I really read your book, which was, I must tell the viewers, it's absolutely a breezy read, very easy read, and you come to know so many unknown facts about Gurudath. So, you know, I have always wondered, and through this, maybe I could get few answers, but I have always wondered that why would a person who had so much going for him, in fact, in the records of Hindi film industry, Gurudath keeps company with likes of filmmakers like Vimal Roy, V. Shantaram, K. Asif, B. R. Chopra, all big wigs. And, you know, thought about him taking his life at the age of 39. It is unbelievable even after so many years, 50 plus years of his going away. So what do you have to say to that?
Yes. Yeah, that was actually what you were asking was the basic idea behind writing this book. Because there were so many books on Gurudath's filmmaking, his technical brilliance, his expertise in choreography and the way films are being shot, song picturization. So there were many books that were exclusive to his cinema, the way he made his films. But when I saw his films on big screen during one of his retrospectives in Delhi, I started reading about him. That was when I was in college. And I realized that, okay, he's making such wonderful films. Why did he, finish his life at a young age of 39? That's not an age to go. So I started reading about him, previous accounts, interviews about him, people talking about him, his co-artists, co-directors and producers talking about Gurudath. But no one was clearly answering these questions. They used to say in most of the accounts, they said, no, his personal life was disturbed or he was going through some negativity in his life. But no one was actually explaining what exactly was that. I, through this book, wanted to write about two main things in Gurudath's life. So one track was, of course, the making of his films, the making of Gurudath. And the second track was that during the making of these classics, while he was producing these classics, one after another, like Pyasa was there, Kagaz Ke Phool was there, Sahib Bibi Aur Ghulam, and before that, some breezy romantic thrillers, Mr. and Mrs. 55 or Bazi or CID. But he was constantly making his cinema. Almost simultaneously, he was attempting to finish his life. There were multiple suicide attempts. It was as if he was going to sleep thinking about ending his own life. And next day he was on set picturizing those brilliant, memorable scenes. I mean, how do you do it? Either you are so, if you're so troubled, if your life is so turbulent, for example, if we are so troubled in our personal life, it becomes difficult to work. We don't like to go to office. We don't like to go to work. We just say, no, we are not feeling like it. My personal life is so tumultuous. But in case of Gurudath, he was living those two lives simultaneously. So that was the peg. I wanted to explore that, those two tracks going simultaneously. So since you have read the book, it goes back and forth.
Yes, it does.
And it talks about two tracks, building of the dream and demolition of the dream simultaneously. Because it was just a very short, brief career of just one decade, 10 years. And in those 10 years, he reached those heights. And within those 10 years, he actually, the downfall also happened simultaneously. He made Pyasa, and that was his first suicide attempt. He made Kagaz Ke Phool, then the second suicide attempt. And simultaneously, he was reaching those heights in his professional life. And simultaneously, his personal life was going to shambles. So that was a very emotional story that I want to capture. So a lot of people told me that if he's a filmmaker, we should only talk about his cinema. In my opinion, his cinema was intensely personal. So he was showing his father's character in Pyasa. In Kagaz Ke Phool, he was showing his own story. He even predicted his death through the climax of Kagaz Ke Phool. So jab itna personal uska cinema tha, unki film mein itni personal thi, to zahir hai, it was connected to his personal life. So we need to explore the personal life also. Ki jo kuch zati zindagi mein ho raha tha, wo apni filmon mein dikha rahe thi. And that's why you feel, you can, you know, still connect with those feelings. Ki wo black and white films to hai, Pyasa, ya Kagaz Ke Phool, ya aur bhi film hai, lekin unko dekh ke aapko lagta hai ki nahi, kahin na kahin to chhu rahi hai hamare dil ko. Wo kyun chhu rahi hai? Kyunki wo apne jazbaat the unke. Wo kori kahaniyan nahi thi. Wo unke apne jazbaat the, aur wo jazbaat kabhi purane nahi hote. Jitna bhi waqt beet jaye, jazbaat, feelings never change. So his films are all about feelings and also about technical brilliance. Abhi bhi aap dekhenge, to you'll not feel that these films are like 50-60 year old, because technically, shot composition wise, choreography wise, and the way he imagined those grand sequences, they feel so, you know, up to date.
Absolutely, and that's the reason why he was considered, I think, the Orson Welles, right?
True.
Right, and also, you know, the kind of movies they were quite three-dimensional, I would say. But you know, I mean, in your book, it's quite an accessible portrait of a filmmaker who was really fighting his inner demons to make very, very extraordinary films, and then the urge to give it all away. But do you think it was also because maybe his illness went unnoticed by the common complacency that we normally Indians, you know, suffer from? And maybe the family thought that maybe he will will himself out of it and he'll be all right. And we don't have to really get worried about his mental issue, you know, relating.
It's a very important question, Neeta, because her sister, Lalita Lajpi Ji, collaborated on the book. And for the first time, she was talking about the personal life of Guru Dutt and Geeta Dutt. And I asked her many times initially, she refused to reply, but gradually when we started talking, I went to meet her in Bombay post-lockdown. She kind of explained everything. She kind of shared everything and told me about his multiple suicide attempts and how she said that there was definitely some mental turmoil, mental illness, which was never diagnosed. Which was never diagnosed because there was just one instance she narrated that they, after his third suicide attempt, the doctor suggested that why don't you consult a psychiatrist? So they called in a psychiatrist. He came home. He had a conversation with Guru Dutt. And later on, he took 500 rupees as his fees. And they laughed. Lalita Ji told me that he actually laughed. But she told me that later on, when I realized, and when after his death, years later, when I read about mental illnesses, I realized that he must be going through something which he was not able to share. And it was such a wrong thing to do that we never called the psychiatrist again. Maybe he would have lived a little longer. Maybe he would have lived and made some more brilliant films, but then she said there was no awareness of mental issues in the 1960s, and I told her that when I was writing this and Sushant Singh Rajput happened, I realized that even in 2020 nothing much has changed. The way we look at mental illnesses. So normally other books and other accounts use the word that perhaps Guru Dutt was depressed, but depression is a clinical thing, and I have not used the word depression. Maybe it was depression, maybe it was something else, maybe it was some other mental illness which was never diagnosed, but definitely there was something which was troubling him a lot, so much so that because this is not a normal thing. Going to, you shoot for the entire day, you're discussing your cinema, you're discussing what I'm going to shoot tomorrow. What sequence is the next sequence? You're planning new films. You're working on new stories. And at the same time, you're trying to end your own life. Because this simultaneous thing that happened was mind-boggling. And this is what I wanted to explore through various accounts of people close to Guru Dutt and Geeta Dutt. And of course, there was a troubled married life also with Geeta Dutt, which added to all his tension.
So very right. In fact, it must have been particularly very, very troubling for you because you were in the middle of the film industry. Mm-hmm. And when you were writing this book, mm-hmm. that time, Sushant Singh Rajput also faced the... So I can understand the trauma you must be going through. Maybe as you mentioned, I think I saw a few of your other interviews in which mm-hmm. you mentioned that it was very, very dark for you because, right?
So, yeah, for at least a month, Neeta. It became dark because it was much... like coming back to Sushant Singh Rajput, it was a much publicized thing. I, as a TV journalist, was, of course, going through all the proceedings and writing scripts during the daytime. You're talking about his death, his mental issues in detail. And then coming back home in the night, I was writing about Guru Dutt's mental condition and writing about his suicide attempts, writing about in detail about his death. You know, it was almost reliving, you know, what happened 4 days before mm-hmm. his death, like I have written in the book, 3 days, last mm-hmm. day, every hour of that day. So when you go through and writing about death so closely and you know, the environment around me during those days, it was lockdown. We have never experienced. Now, of course, we know what a lockdown is and what we need to do. But it was for the first time when it happened last year. And we really didn't know how to cope with it. And in that scenario, writing about two deaths day after day, it kind of became dark for some time. But as a writer, as a storyteller, you have to go through certain emotions because if you're not so involved in your story, I think those you cannot write about those emotions. It's very difficult to understand what these people, be it Sushant Singh Rajput or Guru Dutt, what they must be going through. It must be hell. I'm not saying that I could understand their condition, but even to understand what they must be feeling slightly, you have to let yourself go and get involved in the story. I think that's the only way you can create emotions, and that's the only way you can try to understand what they must be going through.
But in this process, you've given a very, very important inspiration to all the writers in the room, because we get a lot of people who want to write and they come to our sessions, that it's very important to stick with the story. I know.
Yeah, it's like, you know, all the more because writing a book, if kam se kam bhi agar chance lein, toh ek saal ye, this book took 2 years of my life, but agar ek saal bhi laga de, writing a book is very different from making a TV show or writing a story for a newspaper or a magazine, which is like over in 10 days, 15 days. You have to live with your book, with your subject about whom you're writing, be it fiction or a non-fiction. So you live, you kind of keep thinking about your subject. So it's like going to bed with thinking about what your next chapter would be, what Guru Dutt must be going through, what I have to write about his death mm-hmm. tomorrow. I have to read this much. I have to talk to these many people. So you have to live with the character for so long that you start identifying with his feelings. So definitely. And if you can't do it, it becomes very superficial, and it the reader can really notice that. Nahi nahi, ye to upar se likh diya hai. So yeah, to all my writer friends, if they are asked. Some people who are thinking about writing, yes, you have to give that time, and you have to let yourself go while you're writing a story, an emotional story.
Yes, because that's what I noticed. The narrative of the book is so simply written that it's like sometimes it looks as if you're speaking your mind. You're just
I wanted it to be simple. There was a reason, because last book on Guru Dutt was almost 12 years ago, so there is an entire generation who is interested in Bollywood, but he has that generation has heard about Guru Dutt, Wahida Rehman, Pyasa, but they don't really know. They haven't watched Pyasa. They just know it's a great film, like we all do. It's a great film, but we don't watch it. So to write about the subject and the film in such manner, in such a simple manner, so as to be it is accessible to this generation who doesn't have much time to give. The concentration levels are very low. They have a screen in their hands regularly. So to make them watch a two and a half hour long black and white film, I think you have to have a simple narrative. And that was what I was aiming.
In fact, I was going to come back to your wonderfully written book, which has been, as I said, that it has been really taken very well and has gone into the reprint also. So what made you choose Gurudat as your subject? Because, you know, you wrote about Rajesh Khanna, the biggest superstar possible. Then you wrote about Rekha. Everyone is so intrigued about her. And then Sanjay Dutt and Gurudat. And I'm sure you're talking about a reference point of 50s and 60s. So at any point of time, did it really strike your mind that maybe people don't accept this? Maybe I'm going to ultimately talk about maybe 10 years of what he's done. So especially now when the results of the book are so good. How do you relate?
Yeah, to yeah. A lot of people, like I told you, when the first time I watched his cinema on big screen, I was totally mesmerized. So I was very interested when I started reading about him. I said, this is a wonderful story, and this happened, and we don't talk about it very much now. So I discussed it with many publishers even after my first and second book, but no one was really interested, honestly. They said, nahi, Arab Guru Dattab, who's interested? Who will read about him? And this was a story I was living with. And I wanted it out of my system. So after three books, after Sanjay Dutt, I said, let me go back, because I had written about 60s, 70s. No, I had written about 70s, 80s, and Sanjay Dutt was 90s. So I said, I want to go back now. I want to go back to the 50s and 60s. And they said, yeah, write about 50s and 60s, write about him, write about her. I said, no, I'm very particular about my subject, because it is not about his story. It is also the story of the film industry of the 1960s, how they used to function, what was it all about. So thankfully, my editor, we were having dinner together, and we were just discussing, and some Gurudat song was playing, and this just happened by chance, and he said, why don't you tell your, and I told him some anecdotes which are there in the book, like the Gharwala anecdote, the first anecdote, or the Berlinwala anecdote.
Yes.
The book begins with Berlin. So I told him, he said, this sounds brilliant. I think I know a lot about Gurudat, but I have never heard these stories about Gurudat. So why don't, do you think you want to write a book? I said, yeah, of course I want to write a book. And that's how it began. And there are not many people who are alive from his era. And I was also surprised to find there are not many interviews. I think there's not even a single Gurudat interview in question and answer format. Simply no interview. So it becomes very difficult. So Gurudat and Geeta Dutt are alive only in the memories of other people who were close to them professionally or personally. So their story is built through narrated through their memories only. So bas yaadon ke sahare hai ye kahani. Aur ye badi ajeeb baat hai ki Gurudat ki voice bhi jo hai wo dusron ki yaadon ke sahare, unhone khud nahi likha hai. So there are hardly any interviews of Gurudat or Geeta Dutt jahan par wo baat kar rahe ho. To ye apne aap mein tha ki people were not, the media of that time wasn't interviewing Gurudat. There were hardly any, he was hardly on any covers of film magazines of those times. I don't know why. Maybe he was an outsider, but then all others were also outsiders. Film industry was developing. It began 1947 ke baad to sab ban hi raha tha. To sabhi log outsiders the. To ye theory bhi nahi hai. I think ho sakta hai. He never wanted to speak to the media. He was an introvert, or whatever the reason. It's very difficult to know the correct reason, because he's no more. He has never talked about it. So, jitne bhi accounts, there were many accounts in English, there were some accounts in Hindi, Kannada, Bangla. So, during the research process, I had to go through all these accounts. I don't know Kannada or I don't know Bangla. So, I had to take help of my friends and through their help, get as many as stories and write-ups about him as possible. And that's how his life in three-dimensional capacity was, worked upon in the book.
A lot of very nice anecdotes. And you write about this Berlin thing. I mean, you could throughout the book make out that he was quite an enigma, and he was not there but where he was supposed to be. He was always thinking something else. He's a very, very different kind of a person, I would say. Coming back to your book, Yasir, you know, Guru Dutt, Unfinished Story, I think the Pyasa, the movie, you really mentioned quite a few times, and one really runs through it. And I think this movie really immortalized Guru Dutt. In fact, I must tell everyone that it made to the all-time 100 best movies in Time magazine in 2005. Yeah. And in your book, on page number 39, I remember that you've mentioned that Pyasa was how capitalism prostitutes everything. And how final shot in Pyasa took at least something like 104 takes. So please tell us about the filmmaker that was Guru Dutt, especially in context of Pyasa, which really, as I mentioned, immortalized.
There are two things to it. One, he was a perfectionist. And two, he was indecisive. So even if he has taken a perfect shot, he was very indecisive. Ki sahi liya hai ki ghalat liya hai. And for that, he wanted to be so perfect in his mind. And also, Neeta, one very important thing, which I always repeat in all my interviews, is that Pyasa ki jab bhi hum baat karte hai na, it of course was his masterpiece. It remains his masterpiece. So aisa lagta hai ki Pyasa थोड़ी ना मुश्किल सी फिल्म होगी, है ना? प्यासा क्लासिक है, कोई मास्टरपीस है. मतलब जैसे सत्यजीत रे की फिल्म है तो मास्टरपीस है, देखना नहीं चाहिए. व्हाट आई वांट टू से इज दिस आल्सो अप्लाइज टू सत्यजीत रे's फिल्म, दैट प्यासा इज एन इमेंसली एंटरटेनिंग कमर्शियल फिल्म. इमेंसली एंटरटेनिंग मतलब बोरियत का नामो निशान नहीं है. तो बहुत इमोशनल फिल्म है, उसमें कॉमिक एलिमेंट्स भी हैं, उसमें चंपी तेल मालिश सरजो तेरा चक्राए वाला गाना भी है, और इट्स आल्सो एन अटेम्प्ट टू लाइक इट वाज अ कमेंट ऑन द कैपिटलिज्म ऑफ दोस टाइम्स, कि हर चीज बिकने के लिए तैयार है. लाइक के अगर मर गया है, जब तक जिंदा था तो उसकी पोइट्री की कोई कीमत नहीं, उसकी मरते ही उसकी पोइट्री नीलाम होने लगी, और जब वो वापस लौट आया तो कोई उसको पहचानने को राजी नहीं है. इट वॉज यू नो वेरी सिंपली इन अ वेरी सिंप्लीफाइड कमर्शियल वे. बहुत ही बढ़िया डायलॉग बाजी है, जबरदस्त म्यूजिक है. सो इट्स अ कंप्लीट हिंदी कमर्शियल फिल्म. तो प्यासा, जिन्होंने नहीं देखी है, पीपल हु आर लिसनिंग हु वर पार्ट ऑफ दिस कॉन्वर्सेशन, आई थिंक इट्स अवेलेबल ऑन प्राइम वीडियो. देखिए, मजेदार फिल्म है. इट इज अ वेरी एंटरटेनिंग फिल्म. तो एंटरटेनमेंट कभी नहीं भूलते. दैट वॉज the brilliant part about Guru Dutt cinema, it is artistic yet very commercial. To aisa nahi hai ki wo har aam aadmi tak pahunchna chahte hain, hai na? Last person in the masses, that you watch my film, and he used to hold screenings of his films before the film is released, and he used to show it right from the topmost stars to technicians to his driver and makeup person and his cook. And he used to ask them, कि तुमको क्या अच्छा लग रहा है? So one fine day, driver told him, कि सर ये वाला ना सीन बहुत बोरिंग लग रहा है. So he actually removed that scene. You know, that showed that he used to, he was a very democratic filmmaker also in that manner. And अभी तो आमिर खान ये सब करते हैं. सोचिए, आमिर खान अपनी स्क्रीनिंग करते हैं और वो ये सब सबकी राय लेते हैं, which is a very democratic way to do it, कि ये सारे अलग अलग लोग ही तो देखने वाले हैं थिएटर में फिल्म. So you have to take you know, their advice, and if you think you have to work upon it, and he used to do it. So Pyasa, his Pyasa remains his masterpiece, and it should be watched more than being talked about, because it has been talked about. Aur wo film school mein padhai bhi jati hai. I think everyone who is listening to our conversation should watch Pyasa aaj raat mein baith ke. Bada maza aayega, and it's a very emotional film, and you can feel for the characters. बहुत ही हिंदुस्तानी किरदार है. गुरुदत्त ड्यूरिंग हिज इनिशियल फिल्म्स वो बाज बनाते थे, सीआईडी बनाते थे, बाजी बनाते थे, मिस्टर एंड मिसेस 55. ही यूज्ड टू बोरो अ लॉट ऑफ एलिमेंट्स फ्रॉम हॉलीवुड सिनेमा. उनकी सारी थ्रिलर हॉलीवुड फिल्म देख के आते थे, चार चार और मिक्स करके बना देते थे जब तक. बट विथ प्यासा, वो जिसको कहते हैं ना कि अब मैंने अपनी अपनी जो रास्ता है वो ये मेरा रास्ता है, मैंने पा लिया. और उसके बाद से his films became very Indian. They were rooted in Indian culture. His characters became very Indian. Unlike the Hollywood, you know, Devanand jo CID mein ya Bazi mein the. Uske baad bahut Hindustani ho gaye. To Pyasa se unhone apni jo niche thi wo paali thi. Hai na ki mera kaam ye hai, ab maine mujhe rasta mil gaya. Kagaz ke Phool was a very Indian film.
technically it was international for those times. It was the first CinemaScope film of India. बहुत grand है उसके सारे sequences like European films like American films. लेकिन जो characters हैं they are rooted in Indian society. They think in a very Indian way कि अगर वो फिल्मों में काम कर रही है वो लड़की तो अच्छा है, फिल्मों में काम करती है अच्छी नहीं होगी तो छोड़ के चलिए. तो दिस इज अ वेरी इंडियन वे ऑफ थिंकिंग. समटाइम्स आपको अच्छा लगेगा बट ऑल हिज वुमेन कैरेक्टर्स वर वर्किंग वुमेन. मीन राइट फ्रॉम हिज फर्स्ट फिल्म टू हिज लास्ट वो कुछ ना कुछ कर रही थी. अब अगर वर्किंग वुमेन नहीं थी तो बहुत इंडिपेंडेंट वुमेन थी थिंकिंग छोटी बहू तक कि वो वर्किंग नहीं है लेकिन वो उस दौर में सबको बहुत अजीब लगा था कि वो शराब पीती है तो खुलेआम पीती है और बात करती है फिलोसॉफिकल बातें करती है बहुत इंटेलिजेंट है और इंडिपेंडेंट थिंकिंग रखती है जो कि 1963 के दौर में बहुत अजीब था. लेकिन वो नेगेटिव कैरेक्टर नहीं दिखाया था उन्होंने. उससे पहले वैम्प्स जो थी वो क्लब्स में डांस कर रही है एंड दे आर हैविंग अ ड्रिंक तो वो नेगेटिव थी. वो जब हीरोइन बनती है तो वो शराब छोड़ देती है. यहाँ पर जो सेंट्रल कैरेक्टर है साहिब बीवी और गुलाम की और जो पॉजिटिव कैरेक्टर है जो सबको आईना दिखाती है जो अपने पति को भी आईना दिखाती है कि तुम्हारा समाज सड़ा हुआ है तुम मुझे खराब समझते हो बट तुम्हारा समाज सड़ा हुआ है और मैं ही ठीक हूँ यहाँ पर. सो इट वॉज दैट काइंड ऑफ वो उसके बावजूद वो अपनी फिल्मों में जो महिलाएं दिखा रहे थे वो बहुत मजबूत और इंडिपेंडेंट थिंकिंग वाली महिलाएं थी. एट द सेम टाइम बहुत एंटरटेनिंग फिल्म थी. कमर्शियल फिल्म थी. डायलॉग बाजी हो रही है पूरी और न जाओ सैया छुड़ा के भैया सब कुछ वो कमर्शियल डांस और सॉन्ग सब चल रहे हैं तो कमर्शियल सिनेमा था.
आई थिंक दैट वाज द डायकोटमी इन हिज करेक्टर दैट द वे ही वाज प्रोजेक्टिंग द वुमेन इन movies and he had a different equation.
That was a very interesting dichotomy aur wo explore karna bhi zaruri tha kyunki koi Geeta Dutt ki baat nahi kar raha tha. Ha, no one was talking about Geeta Dutt who was a bigger star when they got married. She was a very big star, a singing star. They got married and he was a struggling filmmaker. His life changed, his destiny changed after the marriage with Geeta Dutt. His initial films, Geeta Dutt had a great, I mean, all his films, including Pyasa, Kagaz Ke Phool, Geeta Dutt had contributed immensely. There were many super successful solo songs sung by Geeta Dutt. But at the same time, during the time of the wedding, they had promised, Guru Dutt had promised her, Kanini, aapki singing jari rahegi. But after the wedding, he kind of changed. He became a very successful filmmaker and then there was a big bungalow, there were kids. And then he started saying, nahi, what's the need of going out, singing for other producers? I'm not stopping you from singing, but why don't you just sing for my banner? Just sing for my films, which effectively meant one film per year or maximum two films a year. Though she continued singing for outside banners, but those banners were like B-grade films because for a long time the struggle went on ki tumhe jana hai nahi jana hai and there were many technical things and there was also the emergence of Lata Mangeshkar in those years and she became the number one singer and Geeta Dutt lost her stardom at the same time when Guru Dutt achieved his stardom. So it became a kind of Abhiman-like story. Mera stardom chala gaya aur tumhara hai and you're not doing anything to help me out. So they had their own way of thinking and this became the main conflict in their relationship. And once you lose your stardom, it is also very difficult to gain it back. So it happened with Geeta Dutt. Then there were many stories and then there was the association with Wahida Rehman. She was very upset about it, Geeta Dutt. And then they became alcoholics. And there were too many things, despite achieving everything in life as a family. The family kind of disintegrated very, very soon. So it became a very sad story after that. And that sadness continued to the last day of their lives, life of Guru Dutt and Geeta Dutt, because her death was even more painful than Guru Dutt. After Guru Dutt, she blamed herself for his death and she became a chronic alcoholic and then cirrhosis of liver and finally a very, very painful death. So it's the entire family kind of disintegrated completely.
I think so, because even his brothers. I think it's been a very sad state of affairs. The whole
family. Very sad. You're writing about very sad lives, very sad life, but brilliant films.
Absolutely. In fact, all the three films, Pyaasa and Saheb Bibi Ghulam Kagaz Ke Phool, they're all been absolutely brilliant.
Ah, and even before that, matlab, we don't talk much about Aarpaar and Mr. and Mrs. 55, Bazi CID. They're all good films.
You know, your book is a tale of unrequited love, as we've discussed, and unresolved relationships and unmatched cinematic talent that you've really, really discussed. You know, why did you think, I know there were so many documentaries already made, there were books on him. So why did you think that his his story was still unfinished? And also, why do you think it was to be retold? I mean, I know you have your own style in this, but then why did you think it had to be brought back to the audience?
I think one, because the new generation don't talk much about Gurudutt, and unfinished because this was the word used by his sister, that had he been alive for a few more years, had he been there to talk about what was going on in his mind, there might have been a few more films. There might have been, you know, something positive that came out of Gurudutt and Geeta Dutt's life. So I think that's what I'm quoting his sister, that I think his story remained unfinished. So this was a very, very interesting word. I said, "Acha, itne saal baad, you still feel that his story remain unfinished." And so that was one. So that title belonged to his sister, that unfinished life. But I think we always talked about his work more than what kind of a person he was. And I was very, very intrigued and interested in exploring his personal life. To be very honest. Personal life doesn't only mean gossip or his relationship or what was happening in, you know, while he was making those films with so many people. But I was more intrigued in his personal life because, like I said before, he was narrating his own personal life in his films. So his films were mainly inspired by his personal life. So it was, I find it very intriguing to go into his personal life and try to understand what kind of a person he was, what was going on in his mind. It is mind-boggling. Like I have written in my book that he was making a film. There were fights between him and his wife, Geeta. So Geeta finally told him that you have become a star and I've lost my stardom. And I wanted to be an actress also. So he began directing a film called Gauri with Geeta Dutt. And something happened on the sets. Geeta said, "Ki tachha, tum to chahte ho ki main Wahida Rehman se bhi buri dikhu." And something happened. And that film was shelved.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened in during that anecdote, during that incident on the sets of Gauri, his next film was Kagaz Ke Phool. That he took that entire incident, the real incident, and placed it in the story of Kagaz Ke Phool. So he's telling his actress during the first few scenes of Kagaz Ke Phool, "Ki tum, I am the director here. I am not some, you know, main tumhara koi rishtedar nahi hu. Yahan par main sirf director." Exactly what had happened on this. So he was taking everything from his personal life and showing it on screen in his next film. So his cinema was intensely personal. So, personal life ko kaise sochta hai ek aadmi? Hai na, normally to you watch someone's film, acha theek hai, yahan se uthai kahani aur ye dikha diya, aur meri personal life is different from my professional life. Main alag tarah ki filmein banata hu aur alag tarah ki zindagi jeeta hu. But in his case, it wasn't like that. To wo kahin na kahin ekdam mil jati thi. To wo jo milna ho raha tha, wo that tangent was very important aur bahut interesting tha, bahut dilchasp hai. Aur wo kahani dikhana chahta tha ki wo jis ghar ko wo chahte the puri zindagi unke paas, he never had a stable house. And then he made one of the biggest houses in Bombay, itne posh ilake Palihil mein, which is sab jagah Italy se marble mangaya, Kashmir se lakdi mangayi, and he made a beautiful bungalow. Aur us bungalow mein unko neend nahi aati thi. So he used to subah 5 baje nikal ke apne स्टूडियो जाते थे, वहां छोटा सा मेकअप रूम था, 7x7 का एक कमरा था, वहां पर एक सिंगल बेड था और उस पर घंटों सोते थे। सो दिस वॉज अ स्ट्रेंज डायकोटॉमी, यार ये हो क्या रहा है कि मेरे पास सब कुछ है लेकिन मैं सो क्यों नहीं पाता। यूज टू रन अवे फ्रॉम बॉम्बे, यूज टू गो टू हिज फार्म हाउस, वहां खेती कर रहे हैं। एक बार वहां पे देसी शराब बनाने की का पूरा प्लांट लगा लिया और वो फिर ऐसे ही दे दिया। मतलब यूज टू कि मुझे भागना है बॉम्बे से, मुझे बॉम्बे परेशान करता है, मुझे वहां नींद नहीं आती, मेरे यहाँ झगड़े होते हैं, मेरे रिश्ते में सब कुछ ठीक नहीं है, और मेरे पास सब कुछ है, आई हैव मनी, आई हैव द बिगेस्ट बंगलो, आई हैव माय ओन स्टूडियो, येट आई एम नॉट हैप्पी, आई वांट टू एंड माय ओन लाइफ। तो ये बड़ी अजीब सी चीज है। और मेंटल इलनेस है या नहीं, क्योंकि ये भी बड़ी अजीब सी चीज है कि इफ यू आर मेंटली अनस्टेबल हाउ कैन यू मेक सच ब्रिलियंट सिनेमा। तो बहुत सारे जवाब हैं, सवाल हैं जिनका कोई जवाब नहीं है। No one can get the answers because it's ab koi hai nahi, only he could have answered or someone very close to him could have answered. Yeah, to tarika yahi hai ki unki kahani samne rakh di jaye aur jo logo ko khud samajhne diya jaye ki what he must be going through. That was the only thing I wanted to achieve with this narrative.
Yes, in fact, right now the mental health awareness group is going, the health awareness month is going on. So it is makes all the more sense to talk about similar cases, but maybe we'll do it some other time. But you know, in Kagaz Ke Phool was, I think, the nearest to his life, the movie. And he suffered a major setback when it was really, people didn't like it. There were so many people talking about it. So I think that was, you feel, the one of the biggest setbacks that he suffered.
He could never, we could never recover from that setback. It was a disaster. And post Kagaz Ke Phool, as we all know, he never officially directed a film. Though unofficially, I can say he directed a lot of sequences, including all the songs in his films post Kagaz Ke Phool also. But yeah, but it broke his heart. It broke his heart. And even when he passed away, the day he passed away, the next day he was supposed to show Kagaz Ke Phool to Raj Kapoor, whom he deeply respected. So even after 3 years of Kagaz Ke Phool, even after the next film, Sahib Biwi Aur Ghulam, got a President's Medal, he was not out of Kagaz Ke Phool. He was still talking about, thinking about Kagaz Ke Phool. So definitely, it's heartbreaking if it's a mega project, if it's very close to your heart. It happened with Raj Kapoor during Mera Naam Joker. It, when you become so involved with your film that you cannot separate your professional and personal life. And for a very sensitive person like Guru Dutt, it happened a lot. And it happened majorly during Kagaz Ke Phool. He could never get it out of his system, that disaster, that the way people could never understand what he wanted to convey through that film, the pain he wanted to convey. So he kind of internalized that pain. And if you see his death, it is very, very similar to what was projected in the climax of Kagaz Ke Phool. So they're great references in that film.
Yes. And I also feel that, I think, yeah, that took him finally. And now it is being appreciated all over. I mean, people.
It always happened that people begin to understand your art. It always happened, but that has been the story. But he was also showing this story in Pyasa. Like it is very similar. This emotion is very similar. That when you are no more, people are appreciating you. In case of Pyasa, it was his poetry.
Right. And the second question of the giveaway, I must say, is that who were the two closest friends of Guru Dutt? That's a very easy one, I think. Yasi, what do you think? It's a very easy question. Two of the closest friends of Guru Dutt. Please answer to Shreya directly, and the fastest finger first will get the award. There are a lot of questions coming up in the chat box also. So
Let's take the questions, Neeta, because it's almost it's almost time.
Yes. I like to unmute Preeta. The Mathu, she's also from Bombay and she's from our theater group.
Okay.
Preeta, switch on your.
Hi. Hello.
Hi, Preeta.
I'm also an actor. So I was just thinking, Guru Dutt has been an enigma and everybody has wanted to know, at least artists like us, ki what is it that made him tick so beautifully and then not work at all in his personal life. Do you think he could have been, you know, living in two parallel worlds? So when he's in the studio, it's his workplace and he's on top of his game. He's brilliant.
Yeah,
even
yeah.
Think from personal life, he makes puts it there and he makes fantastic cinema out of it. But when he goes back after the 5 o'clock or whatever time the studio is done and he is going back home, he's in an environment he cannot cope with.
Yeah, I think you answered your own question. I think that's the correct way to describe it. He was a chronic workaholic. Work was everything for him. Everything right from day one, right from during his childhood to, when he started making films or when he was in Uday Shankar's dance center. Work was everything for him. Like he could work for 20 hours straight. He could work for 22 hours straight. That's what his sister told me. That beyond work, it was very difficult to switch off for him. Because even at the dinner table, he used to talk about his cinema with Geeta Dutt, who used to say, "Nahi, ab aap, you're no more the director, Guru Dutt, yeah, you are my husband." And he used to, like if you read the book, he was calling writers who were staying in his bungalow and they were discussing stories. You know, he came back from shooting, he was having dinner with those writers and they were working on new stories. Raat tak do baje, teen baje, they were drinking together, they were talking stories, they were working on new stories. And after 3 days, 4 days, 3 months, 4 months, he would shelve it, shelve the story or the film he was working on. So he was very indecisive also. So that perfection, indecisiveness, and work. Of course, he was not able to switch off. I think, given a chance, he would have like worked 24 hours and not come back home at all. So it's very difficult to understand. You are an actor. You work in a creative environment. I think you would understand this better than me as a writer.
This lockdown situation, when we are discussing something creative, we feel alive. Otherwise, we feel dead. So, you know, brilliant artists are sometimes like that. They just can't cope with normal life.
I think so. The creative people are not meant for normal life, I think. And creative people who are so intense, who are so sensitive, who are so sensitive enough to show, to borrow elements from their personal life and project them on screen. I think it becomes difficult. I mean, it's a very thin line. Agar ye kahin se bhi line khatam hoti hai, to bahut khatarnak ho jata hai. Ki aap personal life dikha rahe ho, professional life dikha rahe ho, wo jo beech ki thin line hai na. If that vanishes, then it becomes really, really difficult to cope with that. So you, as long as you're showing your personal life in kagaz ke phool, aap apni relationship dikha rahe hain, you're showing yourself as a director, and then you're showing ke jab kuch nahi raha, to director is tarah maut tak chala gaya. And if that thin line vanishes, like it did in his case, to wo phir anjaam wahi hua, jo ek fictional film mein tha. So you have to have that balance. Ye bhi cheez hai ki agar wo balance hota unki life mein, to shayad वो सिनेमा उतना खूबसूरत और इतना इंटेंस नहीं होता. तो दोनों चीजें हैं. सो
बट हो सकता है तब वो और ज्यादा दिन रहते और ब्रिलियंट काम
हाँ,
करने के लिए.
हाँ हाँ हो सकता है. मतलब इट्स अ हाइपोथेटिकल थिंग कि हो सकता है उनकी सिनेमा इतना इंटेंस हो ही नहीं पाता अगर वो नॉर्मल आदमी होते. इट बिकेम सो इंटेंस बिकॉज ही वॉज नॉट अबनॉर्मल. व्हेन आई से नॉट, आई एम नॉट टॉकिंग अबनॉर्मल इन अ नेगेटिव सेंस. आई एम जस्ट सेइंग ही वॉज मोर इंटेंस देन ऑल ऑफ अस. He was more intense than a normal person. He was more sensitive than a normal artist. He was very, very sensitive. So, us plane pe jaake hi to aap itni emotional filmein bana sakte hain. Varna mushkil hota hai.
Thanks so much, and I'm definitely going to get your book and read it.
Yeah, thank you. Please do read. Thank you.
Thank you, Supreeta. Last two questions I can take, yes, sir?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. Mr. Vijay Shankar, he's put in a very valid question.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Hello, good evening, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, perfectly.
Yeah. Sir, I have two questions, if you permit me.
Hello. Yeah, please, puchhiye na.
Hello.
Yes. Boliye.
My first question is, my first question is that had Guru Dutt reached his zenith when he died or he was yet on his ascent? I mean, the way Rajesh Khanna ji was reduced to his mere caricature by the time he had died, don't you think that in a way death also rescued him? the way Bollywood
it's again it's again no I think it's again a very hypothetical question. He was too young to go. I mean, 39 was he was making his next film. He came back from shooting his next film the night he passed away. So and it was just a career of 10 years. He might have made some brilliant films, because there was no sign of his downfall otherwise, because he had stopped directing as soon as he realized that he is no more in control of his emotions after the debacle of Kagaz Ke Phool. He started hiring directors. So he was just overlooking his project. He was directing his songs. He was brilliant in his song picturization. So he was song direct karte the, and baki cheeze wo outsourced kar rahe the, which was a very intelligent. I mean, his mind was working brilliantly. Ki mujhse nahi ho raha hai. Meri personal life is in shambles. Main bahut tension mein hoon. To main dusron ko de deta hoon direction, but main overlook karta hoon as a studio malik. और वो बहुत इट वाज वर्किंग प्रॉपरली लाइक साहिब बीबी और गुलाम तो बहुत ही ब्रिलियंट बन गई थी इसी में. चौधरी का चांद वाज हिज बिगेस्ट सक्सेस आफ्टर कागज के फूल बिकेम अ डिजास्टर. चौधरी का चांद उनकी सबसे बड़ी हिट है. तो वो लगातार कामयाब फिल्में और आर्टिस्टिक फिल्में दे रहे थे. तो मुझे लगता था कुछ साल तो डेफिनेटली थे. बाकी लेटर ऑन इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू यू नो प्रिडिक्ट. राज कपूर तो आखिर तक राम तेरी गंगा वैली तक गोल्डन जुबली देते रहे. हाउ डज इट मैटर? If you are brilliant, you are brilliant. So it is very difficult to compare. You cannot compare a Rajesh Khanna to Guru Dutt to anyone. Rajesh Khanna, he tabhi career bahut lamba chala. Matlab, at least for 20 years, he was giving successful films till 1985-86. It was post 86 that his downfall came. So, theek hai. Matlab, it is very difficult to compare. But again, it is a hypothetical question. And मुझे लगता है कि अगले 5-10 साल तो Guru Dutt बहुत कमाल का cinema बनाते ही, because एक मैच्योरिटी भी आ गई.
सर वन मोर क्वेश्चन इफ यू परमिट मी.
हां बोलिए जल्दी
सर. माय सेकंड क्वेश्चन इज दैट वाज गुरुदत्त एन इवेंचुअलिस्ट? आई मीन आफ्टर कागज के फूल ही स्टॉप बीइंग ऑफिशियली डायरेक्टर्स ऑफ डायरेक्टर ऑफ हिज फिल्म्स लाइक साहब बीवी और गुलाम. ऑफिशियली ही वाज नॉट इट्स डायरेक्टर. But the movie has his fingerprints. If you watch the
because,
movie,
because he was there. One, there are two reasons to it. That he was involved in the writing of the film, completely involved. One, number two, he was the producer. He was there during the shoot of most of its part, and he directed the songs. That is an official thing. He directed the songs, but I think he did not direct the film. It was directed by Abrar Ali, who was his writer, who was his closest associate.
He was officially the director.
मुझे लगता है वो director थे ही. Except the songs, Abrar Ali was director, but they used to discuss every scene. तो वो जो आप कह रहे हैं and the entire team. आपको क्यों लगता है गुरुदत्त की छाप थी? क्योंकि अच्छा ये shot तो गुरुदत्त का लग रहा है, but it was shot by the same team जो गुरुदत्त की team थी. It was shot by VK Murthy. सब कुछ तो वही, सारे लोग वही थे. लाइटमैन भी वही था, सब कुछ वही था. तो आपको लगता है कि वही था. प्लस बिफोर एवरी सीन दे यूज्ड टू डिस्कस. सो शॉट टेकिंग वाज बाय अब्रार अलवी. इट वाज ऑफिशियली डायरेक्टेड बाय अब्रार अलवी, येट द सॉन्ग्स वर डायरेक्टेड बाय गुरुदत्त. सो ये क्लैरिटी है इसमें. तो इसमें कोई शक की गुंजाइश नहीं है. ही डिडंट डायरेक्ट साहिब बीवी और गुलाम. इट वाज डायरेक्टेड बाय अब्रार.
Thank you so much, sir. And I'm looking forward to read the book.
Ji, bilkul padhiye, bilkul padhiye. I would love to get your feedback.
Sir, I'm myself a big Gurudat fan.
Bilkul padhiye, aapko maza aayega. It's a very emotional book, and do read it.
Thank you so much, Yasir.
Thank you, Neeta. Thank you, Shreya, for the wonderful opportunity, and it was lovely talking about Gurudat and his cinema again. Thank you so much, and all the best for your show.
Thank you.